Welcome all. You've all been so patient that we don't want to keep you waiting any longer. Thank you for coming. I'm here to welcome you to tonight's event, to give you a brief bio on Jonathan Haidt, and to do some housekeeping items with you. Sounds like we're getting Professor Haidt all mic'd. Okay, we're good to go? Okay. My name is Barbara Altman. I'm the director of the Oregon Humanities Center. The Oregon Humanities Center is a research center housed at the University of Oregon in Eugene. The center is charged with the support of humanist research and teaching and with public programming for the larger community. We work actively to partner with community partners and other institutions supporting the humanities across the state, and I'd like to acknowledge our local communication partner, Oregon Humanities, a name very similar to ours. They were formerly known as the Oregon State Council for the Humanities, and they're based here in town. They help us get the word out about our programming here in Portland and across the state. Jonathan Haidt is the last speaker in a series this year that we called Human Being Being Human. One of our other featured guests, physician Ira Byock, gave a talk here in January 2013, just a couple of months ago. Thank you, Peg. On mortality, morality, and end-of-life issues. Did any of you come to hear Dr. Byock? Oh, that's great. So we've got some repeat audience members. That's wonderful. Glad to see you back. We will bring a couple of speakers to Portland next year as well, when our theme is going to be the single word, vulnerable. So we'll be exploring vulnerability next year. We'll give you lots of warning on that one and let you know when we're going to be up here. For now, however, Jonathan Haidt is the closing presenter of this year's series, and we're really delighted to have him. Even though he's the last to come, he was the very first on our list when we decided to explore the human condition from a variety of perspectives. Haidt spent 16 years as a professor of psychology at the University of Virginia before taking a job last year as the Thomas Cooley Professor of Ethical Leadership at New York University's Stern School of Business. Haidt's work examines morality and emotion and how they vary across cultures. His current research focuses on the moral foundations of politics, as you'll guess from the title tonight, and on ways to transcend the culture wars using recent discoveries in moral psychology. His recent book, The Righteous Mind, Why Good People Are Divided by Politics and Religion, has received all kinds of positive attention in the print media and all other forms of media. You might have seen his excellent interview with Bill Moyers last year, or caught him holding his own with Stephen Colbert on the Colbert Report. I'm curious to know, did any of you hear Jonathan Haidt on Portland's Think Out Loud a couple of days ago? Oh, that's really good for us to know. That's great. I'm glad you heard it. It's on their archive if you want to go back and listen to it after the fact. If you're interested in other recent and local interviews, please check out the one he did with me yesterday for our TV show called UO Today. It'll air across the state on public access TV in a couple of weeks, and it'll be available on our website, Oregon Humanities Center at the University of Oregon homepage. That's the easiest way to get to it. I should also point out that Haidt gave another different talk last night in Eugene. The title of that one was How Human Beings Got Morality, Religion, Civilization, and Humanity. And we had over 400 people there to hear it. We taped it, and it too will very soon be available on our website if you'd like to hear that one as well. Professor Haidt is here today to deliver the Oregon Humanities Center Kritikos Lecture 2013 for 2012-2013. It's an endowed lectureship. And it was established with a gift in 1993 from some very generous supporters of the center. Its purpose is to bring to the university and the state of Oregon distinguished scholars, critics, and leaders in the humanities in order to promote, and I quote from the gift, intellectual honesty and freedom, recognition of the worth of open and honest civic discussion, and critical analysis of differing viewpoints and values, end of quote. The language of the gift specifies that the speaker should be in some way a contrarian. So we always have a jolly time finding that speaker for the year. If you know Haidt's work already, you may understand why he fits the bill. And if his work is new to you, I think you'll understand by the time you finish hearing him speak today. Before I turn over the mic to our guest, let me give you an idea of what to expect. Dr. Haidt has agreed to take questions from the audience after he finishes speaking. There are two microphones in the aisles, and we'd like to ask you to come to the microphone if you do have a question. We are live streaming this, and so if you don't speak into the mic, our audience watching from afar won't be able to hear your question. If you can't come to the mic or prefer not to, we have a portable mic, a cordless one that we can bring to you. We can just raise your hand and one of us will bring it over to you. After the Q&A, Haidt will be signing books. There will be a book sale and the signing table as well, just outside this main room in the lobby. And I'll escort Professor Haidt there as soon as we're finished with a question and answer. As we end another year of programming, I'd like to make sure to thank my colleagues at the Oregon Humanities Center. You'll see them in and just outside of the room. They would be happy to answer any questions you have or to help you sign up for our newsletter, either in hard copy or electronic version. And now let me move on to what you've come to hear. For his talk, What on Earth is Happening to Us? Polarization, Demonization, and Paralysis in American Politics. Please help me welcome Jonathan Haidt.
Thank you, Barbara, and good evening, Portland. I have some good news and some bad news. Which do you want to hear first? No. It's only funny if I give you the good news first. You know, the setup has to be that, and then we go to the... Okay, so let's try it again. I have some good news and some bad news. Which do you want to hear first? Great. Well, so the good news is that in the big picture, everything is fantastic. Here is a portrayal of the last 2,000 years and what's happened on our planet. This shows how wealth and comfort and everything else is rising so incredibly dramatically. I know you can't see the numbers in the back. I'll just walk you through it. This is a graph of the basically the dollars per capita in, let's call it 1995 dollars. It doesn't really matter. The entire world back in the year zero, the entire world was living on the equivalent of a dollar a day, whatever subsistence, enough to just scratch out a living and not starve to death. That's the way everybody was living, other than, you know, the 1%. And that was true all over the world. It only begins to go up a little bit after, in the age of discovery, here's 1500. So the European bar, this blue bar is the Europeans. The Europeans begin actually getting a little richer. They get trade goods. They get out of feudalism. So the Europeans go from nothing to, on average, two times nothing. And they're doing a little better than the others. And then America comes into being. America's the Green Line, rise along with them. And then in this period, this crucial period, the West invents democratic capitalism, and you get the beginnings of the Industrial Revolution. And look what happens to America. It goes from, you know, almost nothing to a per capita income of about $9,000 per person by 1950. So that's an incredibly dramatic rise just in the space of that of the Industrial Revolution. And if you're not blown away by that, this is what's happened just in the year since 1950. Look at that. We are making unbelievable progress. And the amazing thing is, it's not just us. Well, sure, Western Europe, not a surprise, but Eastern Europe, once it throws off communism, But Eastern Europe is on its way up. Now, note this graph only goes to 2001. So what you see here is China and India beginning to poke their heads up. They had rejected free markets and capitalism until the 80s and 90s, respectively. As soon as they embrace trade and join themselves onto the world, they start shooting up. And if we do this graph again in 10 years, they're going to be right up there. And that's half of humanity right there. And this is happening all over the world. So wealth is skyrocketing, and extreme poverty is plummeting. It's heading towards zero within a couple of decades. Extreme poverty means living on $1.50 a day or less. This shows the data for China. It used to be 1981, 80% of Chinese were scratching out a living. But as I said, once they embrace capitalism, bang, it goes to zero. It's going to go to zero very soon. India is on the same trend, a little slower. The rest of the developing world. Africa's a little slower, but according to calculations, calculations done country by country, if you project out recent trends, almost every African country is also expected to hit zero by 2030. So extreme poverty. When I was growing up in the 70s, we all thought, oh, you know, we want to find an end to poverty and nuclear war. And, you know, who could have imagined that actually poverty would be eradicated, extreme poverty? Now, they're going to go from a dollar a day to $3 or $4 a day. But that's a huge improvement. And then in a few more decades, it'll be 5, 10, 20, 50. You know, it's that curve, that incredible curve. The whole planet is on it now. Democracy is triumphant. This is the number of countries ruled by autocracies, dictatorships. High point was in the 1970s. Look what's happened since the 1970s. Plummets, democracies are skyrocketing. I've put a green box around the period since 1980, the key period of interest for us tonight, and you'll see why later on in the talk. So democracy is winning out everywhere. Genocide has basically disappeared. I mean, there have been a couple of small ones, Rwanda being the most notable exception. But this is the 20th century. This is the number of people killed in genocides in the 20th century since World War II. Down, 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 down. It's essentially zero now. It's not just around the world. It's America, too. This is the rates of rape and homicide in the USA since reaching their peaks in the 1970s, the crime wave of the 70s. Look what's happened. Homicide is down more than 50%. Rape is down about 80 or 90%. It's unbelievable. America is getting so safe. I live in New York City. It's unbelievably safe. I never see cops. I never see crime. It's like I grew up outside New York in the 70s. I can't, you know, it's like, what planet is this? But everything's changing for the better. Racism is plummeting. These are survey items. Would you move if a black family moved next door? Most people said yes in 1940, but it's just gone. These sorts of attitude items have gone steadily, steadily down to essentially zero. Nobody says that in America anymore. You remember that nuclear war thing? If you're over 40, you grew up thinking that the world could be destroyed in a nuclear war. Now, of course, it could still happen that a warhead goes off. That very well could happen, but it's going to be one. Or at most two. Could be some exchange. But it's not going to be a planetary, life-ending thing. I grew up thinking 50-50. 50-50 that we survive a century without a nuclear war. This was this movie, The Day After. Raise your hand if you remember this movie from the 80s. So yeah, the older folk mostly remember it. This is what our cities were supposed to look like. This is what it would look like on The Day After. And if it wasn't from nuclear war, it was going to be the crack epidemic. But that didn't happen. And why? Because the Cold War is over, and we won it. America won World War I, World War II, and the Cold War, removed the threat of nuclear war. Things are amazing. We should all be dancing in the streets. This is the best time in human history to be alive. Who could have imagined we would have vanquished all these incredible problems? And yet it doesn't feel that way. It doesn't feel so great right now. Why is that? The reason it doesn't feel so great is that happiness is relative in two ways. First, it is relative to how everyone else is doing. And so 20, 30, 40 years ago, we were the premier power. We were the richest by far. We were the number one nation, no doubt about it. And while America is still getting better in some ways, other nations are getting better much, much faster. If we look simply at economics, this is GDP in America, total, not per capita. This is the total GDP. So America has been the largest, the richest nation for a very long time. And the red bar is China. Now, this is total. It's not per capita. So China is going to become the largest economy in 2016. They're going to surpass us. And as they go up faster and faster, if they continue it, they will eventually match us per capita. So that's great, isn't it? 30, 40 years ago, didn't you want an end to world poverty? Well, yes, but now that they're all catching up to us, it doesn't feel so good because relative to them, we're not doing as well as we were. It's also relative. Happiness is also relative to how we were doing a little while ago. So we notice our minds are terrible at noting absolute levels of things, but they're superb at noting minute changes of state. Are things getting better or worse relative to how we were? And relative to how we were, say, in the 1990s, a lot of things have declined, and I'll be talking about that, actually, now. So so let's move on. Why does it feel as though America has sort of gone off a cliff or run out of road or the good times are over? Why does it feel that way? Well, that's the bad news. That's what I'll be talking about the rest of the evening. But bear in mind that overall the picture is fantastically good. Okay, now let's talk about American politics. Okay, things are not so good there. I'm going to show you the story of America's decline and descent into paralysis and problems in three graphs. Three graphs tell the story. So the first is a graph that shows polarization in Congress. So everybody agrees our political elites have gotten very, very polarized rapidly over the last few decades. This graph by some political scientists, it charts for the House in red and the Senate in blue. It charts the degree to which you can predict each congressperson's vote just by knowing where they are on the left-right spectrum. So the degree to which the left-right axis perfectly predicts votes or whether there's a lot of shifting and flexibility. So that's this is a measure, one measure of political polarization. What you see is that in the 30s, 40s, and into the 50s, it was very low. And then it starts going up in the 70s, and it keeps going up and up and up steadily. In the House, it's about as polarized as it can possibly be. The Senate is a little bit better, but it's still quite bad. Now, why has that been happening? We'll talk about that. It's important, though, to show what happened before this period, which is this. So this is the Civil War is back here. The post-Civil War period, America's extremely polarized. It plummets after World War I and through the Great Depression. So this is the important point to take away here is that this mid-20th century period is actually an historical anomaly. We will probably never get back to that super low level, but man, why are we higher than we were at the Civil War? That is crazy. All right, that's the first graph. Second graph. Some political scientists say that the people are not really getting more polarized. On many specific attitude issues, the people aren't really further apart. But in some ways, they are further apart. Not as much, they haven't polarized as much as Congress, but on some measures, they have polarized. Here's one of the clearest. They polarized in that what Republicans and Democrats think about each other has gotten much, much more negative. So every 2 years, the American National Election Survey does a nationally representative survey of Americans on hundreds of questions about politics. One series of questions is called a feeling thermometer. How warm or cold do you feel about the Supreme Court, or African Americans, or the military, or the Republican Party, or the Democratic Party? 100 means very warm, really like them. 0 is very cold, really hate, you know, really strongly dislike them. And what we see up here, these two lines, the blue line shows what Democrats say about the Democratic Party. And not surprisingly, from this goes back to the Carter administration through the Obama administration, Democrats generally like the Democratic Party. Okay, that's not a surprise. Republicans generally like the Republican Party, and there's no change over the last 40 years. How do you feel towards the other party? How do Democrats rate Democrats' ratings of the Republican Party in blue here are below the midpoint, but actually not much. So back in the 70s and 80s, Democrats gave negative ratings to the Republican Party, but only in the 40s, only slightly below the midpoint of the scale. And they drift downwards a little bit through the Clinton administration. Same thing for Republicans. Republicans give negative ratings to the Democratic Party, but not that negative, and it drifts down a little bit. But here's what happens. It begins in the late Clinton administration with the impeachment trial. Things get much nastier then, but especially under Bush and Obama, bang, down they go. So in the last 10 years, things have gotten a lot worse. Republicans really dislike Democrats and the Democratic Party, and vice versa. Third graph. Americans had very high trust in their government in World War II and in the decades after. Whichever party was in power, Americans basically thought that the government did the right thing. This is an ANES survey question. The three responses. How often do you trust the government to do what's right? The top choice is pretty much all the time, most of the time, or none or almost none of the time. And so what percent gave either of the top two responses, most or all the time, you trust the government? Before Vietnam and Watergate, trust was very high. That would be true back in the before the Johnson administration. But after all the deception and the law breaking in Vietnam and Watergate, trust plummets in the Nixon administration, Ford, and then down to the they sort of reached their bottom, their terrible plateau down here. So that's the first thing. There was a big drop in trust in government in the 70s. That's the first thing to note. And then it stays relatively stable. The second thing to note is there's the difference between the parties, but it's not a mean difference. The averages are pretty similar. It's a difference in variance. What that means is that Democrats here are relatively stable. Whichever party has the presidency doesn't much matter. There's not really a relationship. There, you know, only about 30% of them say they trust the government, regardless of which party is in power. Republicans are much more variable. Under Carter, very low. Oh, Reagan, much higher. Well, Bush, they didn't give the benefit of the doubt to. But, you know, Clinton, bad. Bush, too, good. So Republicans are much more sensitive to who is in office. Once you know that, you can guess what happens when Obama comes into office. You would expect that it goes down. Maybe, so this is 30. This is where things have been. Maybe it's going to go down to historic lows. Maybe it'll go below 30. Maybe it'll go to 20, lower than it's ever been. Well, let's see. 5% of Republicans say, 5% say they trust the government to do what's right most of the time or better. Five. That's not just the Tea Party. That's everyone, except for five of them. Well, okay. So that's why we get these really angry, these charges of treason, treachery. He's a Kenyan socialist, all those sorts of things. Almost absolute zero trust in government. So those are the three graphs that tell the story. Okay, so now let's move on to why. What happened? And why did things get so much worse in the last 10 years? They've been getting steadily worse, but especially in the last 10 years. What's going on? The biggest single piece of the answer is this, that the parties used to be somewhat mixed. There were liberal Republicans. There were conservative Democrats. And that meant that the parties weren't totally opposite in terms of their values. The parties used to be coalitions of industries and regions. They weren't a sort of personality and values. They were a sorting of interest groups and coalitions that kept shifting over time. So how we get from the party of Lincoln to the party of Bush is a quite circuitous path. How we get from Douglas to Obama, again, quite circuitous path. Just going to flip through slides. This is fascinating to look at. These are the electoral maps. Blue, obviously, it means Democrats carried the state in the 1860 election. And red is Republicans. And in the election of Lincoln, here's the way the map looked. What I want you to note is that the Democratic Party has always been the Southern Party. The South votes for Democrats, in part because Lincoln was a Republican. But so you're going to watch over and over again. You're going to see the South is blue. The Northeast and the West Coast are Republican. It's always been. So watch what happens. Here's Teddy Roosevelt. Here's Coolidge. So there you get a perfect sort, South versus everyone else. Here's Eisenhower. Here is Eisenhower again. And here's Kennedy. So Kennedy, you know, sometimes you'll pick up other states, but the South, the Democratic Party is the Southern Party. Then comes the Civil Rights Act. And on the day that Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act, he said to Bill Moyers, who was his aide, he said, "We've just turned the South over to the Republicans for the rest of my life and yours." And sure enough, this is what happens on the very next election. This is not an optical, you know, those optical illusions where you look at an American flag in reverse and then you look at a wall and the colors are opposite. This is not that. This is what actually happened. The colors have flipped, perfectly flipped. Then you get Wallace. You get some screwy stuff going on there with the South in Wallace. Then you get the Nixon landslide. So the 70s, this is the period when those incredibly stable facts about the parties are totally realigning. This is the most important cause, the realignment of the parties, leading to ultimately a purification by values, which we never had before. So we get a Southern Democrat. Temporarily, we get the old pattern back, but this is the last time you're going to see it. And again, notice, the West Coast has been solidly Republican in every single image, except for the Johnson landslide. Oregon has always been a Republican state. 1980, Reagan again. Now, for the first time, the Northwest goes blue, and it never goes back. So 92, now this is the first time we see what is at least recognizable as our current electoral map. Bill Clinton is where the realignment finally became visible. You know, you sort of shake up the crystal ball. It's now beginning to look recognizable. So this is why the 90s is really the key period when things really turned and got really bad, and then they accelerated more recently. So here's Clinton's second election, Bush again, Obama. I mean, look how amazingly stable it's been. Hardly any change the last. So this is where we are now. It's a totally new alignment based not on region, based not on interest, based on values. So that's the first cause. Second cause of this rising polarization is that we had this temporary period where our politics was dominated by largely by men who had fought in World War I and then World War II. Great wars create great citizens. They bring people together for the good of the nation. People learn to get along. They think about the nation. So when the greatest generation, which was prepared by its childhood to put America's interests first ahead of other interests, when that generation gives way in the 90s to baby boomers, what was the baby boomers' foundational experience? When they were in their 20s, what were they doing? It wasn't fighting for an evil. It was fighting the other side, which was perfectly evil. Either they were, you know, racist, fascist Republicans, or they were commie, pinko, hippie, subversive liberals. Also, combined with that, we get rising individualism and self-expression, less a sense of a value on self-control, more a value on expressing yourself and yelling and screaming if that's what you want to do. And the result is we go from greatest generation political leaders who could have personal relationships, who could joke, who could drink together, even though they could fight as well, but they could make up, they could be friends. We go to the first baby boomer couple that did not like each other, but the culture in Washington was such in the 90s that they could still work together. But that's not true anymore. And now that everybody's a baby boomer, there aren't any greatest generation people left. Now we have really no love lost between those two. That's the second cause. Third cause is that we had this temporary period when Americans got their news from relatively nonpartisan sources. If you go back to the days of the Founding Fathers, every newspaper was a partisan newspaper. And that's the way the news has traditionally been. And then television is invented, and there's three networks. And there's all kinds of reasons why they can't do politics. There are legal restrictions, so there's three fairly centrist television networks. That was temporary. That couldn't last, and it hasn't lasted because this is where we are now. So you basically, the internet is the greatest gift to the confirmation bias ever. The confirmation bias is where we seek out information to support our prejudices. We do not want to know things that contradict our beliefs. So the internet, you just Google whatever you want, and you'll get it. Fourth cause, as we get rising wealth and rising individualism, now people don't stay where they were born, and they don't just go where the jobs are. They go to a place that will have used bookstores and coffee shops and won't fluoridate its water or something like that. So you get people living in lifestyle enclaves. And the fundamental sort now, it's turning out, this is not true before, but what's really stabilized in the last few years, the fundamental sort is simply density, pure population density. This is an amazing graph made up by Dave Troy. He just looked at every single county in the U.S., and you plot not the total number of people, but the density per square mile. And what you see is that as density rises, you can't read these numbers, I'll just tell you, as density rises from 10 people per square mile, where two-thirds of the people voted for Romney in those very sparsely populated ones, as it rises from 10, 30, 70, 100, very stable. There's no, you know, if it's below 500, well, the inflection point is 1,000. If you live in a county that has fewer than 1,000 people per square mile, your county voted for Romney. At 1,000, bang, it flips. More than 1,000, it's like a switch gets flipped and most people now vote for Obama. And you might recognize this state. This is the electoral map of Oregon by county. You see what I mean? There's only one, which is dark blue. I don't have the key here, but dark blue is really, really big victory for Obama. It's right. I don't know what county that is, but it's, yeah, okay. The fifth reason why things have gotten so bad is changes in the House of Representatives that I think can be laid directly at the feet of Newt Gingrich. I mean, I don't want to be too harsh on him in that the Democrats, when they controlled Congress for decades, they were not exactly nice to the Republicans. They shut them out. So Gingrich had a right to be mad as hell. And when Gingrich, when the Republicans finally took over the House in 1995, he came in, he made a lot of changes. One of them was that committee chairman used to be assigned by seniority. So they didn't have to toe the party line. If you were the most senior, you'd serve the longest on the House Ways and Means Committee, you were going to be the chairman when your party took control. But Gingrich changed it so that the chairmen were appointed by him. And that meant that they had to toe the party line. They couldn't compromise with the other side. They had to do what he wanted. In a variety of ways, the minority party was even more shut out. Gingrich made changes to the legislative calendar, which were absolutely crippling, because it used to be that congressmen lived in Washington. And if you move your family to Washington, your spouses have to do something. So they run charities with the spouses of the other side, and they have charity balls, and your kids go to the same private schools, and your families know each other, and you have human connections. Now, for those of you who have ever met congressmen, and it's true at almost any level, congressmen are amazingly socially skilled people, for the most part. I don't know about Anthony Weiner, but most of them are. There's an incredible, they're like these amazing, these extroverts. They know everybody's name. They're really warm people. Now, this is actually one of Obama's problems. He's not an extrovert. He's more cerebral. But most congressmen are incredibly gregarious. And this is crucial for making sausage, for making law, for dealing, for cajoling, for persuasion. So you have these incredibly socially skilled people who need to use that skill to compromise, to make deals, to make friendships across the aisle. And now what happens? Gingrich changes the calendar so that all business is done from Tuesday afternoon through Thursday morning. Congressmen now stay in their home districts. They fly in just for a couple of days. They don't own a house. They don't even rent. They basically have a room in a dorm, sort of, with other congressmen. They don't meet people on the other side. The little trains under the Capitol that they ride to for the office buildings, there is a Republican train, Democrat. They do not meet each other. And that's the way Gingrich and others wanted it. So when you have a breakdown of relationships, of course you have a breakdown in the legislative process. So there's no more fraternizing. Now, that was in the House, but then the culture of Washington changes, and who are the senators? Senators are mostly ex-congressmen. So the Senate became much more polarized as well. So there are many other causes. We could talk about this all night. I'm going to skip ahead and move on to what can we do? What now? Most of those causes that I showed you, and some of these as well, cannot be undone. I mean, end of the Cold War. We don't want to undo that one and have another Cold War to unite us all. So most of those causes cannot be reversed. So we will never get back to the levels of bipartisan cooperation that we had in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. That's never going to happen. I mean, not in the next 100 years. It's not going to happen. But there's no reason for us to be higher than the Civil War. There's no reason for that. I think we could get back to the levels of the 90s, which were bad but still functional. So polarization is here to stay. We can't get back to the Golden Age, but we can do better. Here's a really good book by Alan Abramowitz in which his conclusion is, he says, I will argue that the only realistic alternative to continued gridlock in Washington is not a revival of bipartisanship, but an American version of responsible party government. That means the system they have in Europe, where if your party wins, you get to make laws. And then the voters can judge, did it work or not? And if they like what you did, you get reelected. And if they don't, they throw you out. That's what happens in Britain. That's what happens in parliamentary systems. But here, who do you blame? Because one party has one house, no party can actually do what it wants. So do we blame the obstructionist minority party? Who do we blame? So he says, responsible party government cannot work without some fundamental reforms, especially ending the filibuster. It's just crazy that we give the minority basically the right to stop everything. And not just the minority. Any individual can put an anonymous filibuster, and nobody even knows who it is. It's crazy that we allow that to happen. So we have to end the filibuster. There's a really great group called NoLabels.org, which has they have a 12-point plan. A few of the points are kind of gimmicky, but some of them are very good. Some of the most important filibuster reform, they don't want to end it. They just want to return it to the way it used to be, which is if you want to do what Rand Paul did and stand up there and talk for hours to slow things down and force debate, go ahead, do it. But you can't have these anonymous filibusters that hold things up for weeks or months without any responsibility. Up and down presidential appointments, it's just crazy. There's no defense for saying that when the president nominates somebody for a judgeship or to head an agency, that it can take a year or two to confirm. That's crazy. Who is served by that? That's just obstructionism. So the change would be anybody the president nominates is automatically confirmed in 60 days if he is not voted against. So that would solve that problem. change the legislative calendar, make them spend 3 weeks in Washington, so 3 weeks of solid work, 5 day work weeks, and then a week off. It'd be so much easier on them. They wouldn't have to fly so much. They would actually get more done. They would be able to meet each other. A few other bipartisan leadership committees. I mean, there are a bunch of ideas, but I think they're really good. And they have gotten 70 congressmen to sign on to be problem solvers. They meet once a month. They actually are meeting each other. And they're going to be introducing some legislation jointly, which is really encouraging. So this group is actually making things happen. If you want to read more about what's going on, these are the two best books I've read. It's Even Worse Than It Looks by Thomas Mann and Norm Ornstein, and The Parties Versus the People by Mickey Edwards. They are sort of center-left, and he is sort of, Mickey Edwards is a former Republican congressman, he's sort of center-right. So two good books that give slightly opposing views, but generally agree. So that's sort of the history and the political science of this. We could go on all night about that, but that's not my expertise. My expertise is psychology. I'm a social psychologist. And social psychology hasn't played a big role in understanding what's been going on, but I think if you know something about moral psychology, all that other stuff will make a lot more sense, because there are real people there doing this, and we, the voters, are real people with this complicated moral psychology. So in our remaining time, I'm just going to talk about how moral psychology can help us understand what's happened and help us move forward as a people. A great line from Julius Caesar, from Shakespeare's Julius Caesar, the fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars but in ourselves, that we are underlings. And I would revise that for the American electorate. The fault, dear voters, is not entirely in our politicians and institutions, but in ourselves, that we are too righteous, too quick to demonize. So this is what my book is about. This is the hardcover edition. Stefan Sagmeister, a graphic designer, created with an actual slit in the cover. That's what it feels like in America. Something's ripped, something's torn. This is the UK hardcover, which also captures another aspect of moral psychology. And this is the American paperback, which captures the idea of demonization, polarization. The book, I tried to use everything I know about psychology to write the book. I tried to make it intuitively persuasive. I tried to make it simply organized so that the basic ideas could be grasped easily. and so part of that was I boiled moral psychology down to three sentences, three ideas. If you get these three, then you understand the most important findings in moral psychology. So I'll run through them briefly, and we'll talk about how they apply and how they can be used. So the first is that intuitions come first, strategic reasoning comes second. So here's the way to think about that. There's a long tradition in Western thinking, going back to Plato, and actually you find this all over the world, the idea that the mind is divided into parts that sometimes conflict. This is the foundational truth. My first book, The Happiness Hypothesis, is about 10 great truths. This is the first one. The mind's divided into parts that sometimes conflict. And it's common, especially in the West, to see those parts as reason versus emotion, and to lament the fact that emotion is so powerful. So Plato gave us the metaphor that the mind is like a charioteer driving two horses. So the charioteer is reason, and if reason struggles mightily, if a man learns philosophy, he can control the unruly passions, the noble passions and the base passions. So if a man studies philosophy and can control his urges, his soul, when he dies, will return to the heavens, which are the realm of the gods. The gods are perfectly rational. If a man fails to study philosophy, fails to control his urges, then when he dies, his soul will come back to earth as a woman. Because that's so that was the view of reason and emotion that the Greeks had. Against that view, there are occasional voices in the philosophical literature that say, no, 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 that worship of reason, that got it all wrong. And David Hume is the preeminent philosopher who said that. One of his most famous lines, reason is and ought only to be the slave of the passions and can never pretend to any other office than to serve and obey them. So reason is not the noble, mighty charioteer. Reason is a servant that does what it's told by the passions. I think a better metaphor is reason as the press secretary. This is Robert Gibbs, Obama's first press secretary. So he's a very, very smart guy. He's not just like a waiter. He's a very, very smart guy. He works for Obama. He basically does what he's told. So he goes out and you have press conferences and he gives reasons for the policies of the administration. And it just can't happen that some reporter asks a really hard question and says, well, doesn't that contradict what you said last month? It can't happen that Gibbs would then say, wow, you're right. I better go tell the president. Okay, that cannot happen. And I believe that that is a great metaphor for the relationship between reason and intuition. So to explain this, I'll just read a few paragraphs from the book, from chapter 4. This is a section called Reasoning and Google Can Take You Wherever You Want to Go. When my son Max was 3 years old, I discovered that he's allergic to must. When I would tell him that he must get dressed so that we could go to school, he would scowl and whine. Nobody wants to be told you must do something. But if I said, can you get dressed so that we can go to school, then he'd be much happier with that. The word can is just so much nicer than the word must. So to be certain that these two words were really having opposite effects, I did a little experiment. One night after dinner, I said, in a very even, flat voice, I just said, Max, you must eat ice cream now. And he said, I don't want to. And then right away, I said, Max, you can have ice cream now if you want. I want some. Okay, that only works with a three-year-old. Five-year-olds are too smart for that, but if you have a three-year-old, try it. The difference between can and must is the key to understanding the profound effects of self-interest and politics on reasoning. It's also the key to understanding many of the strange beliefs that people hold in UFO abductions and such things. There's a social psychologist at Cornell named Tom Gilovich, and he gives us this very simple formulation. He says, when we want to believe something, we ask ourselves, can I believe it? Can I believe it? Do I have permission to believe it? And then what you do is you send out your press secretary, say, go find me a piece of evidence to support the belief that Obama is a Muslim, or whatever it is you want to believe. Just find me a piece of evidence. And reasoning goes out, maybe it Googles it, maybe you find something. You come back, boss, here's a piece of evidence. Got it. Okay, I'm justified. I can believe it. In contrast, when we don't want to believe something, we ask ourselves, must I believe it? Must I believe it? And then you send reasoning out to look for one piece of contradictory evidence. If you find one reason to doubt, you know, that global warming is caused by human beings, or that a fetus doesn't feel pain, whatever it is that you want to doubt, you just find one piece of evidence and you're done. You can stop thinking. Psychologists now have file cabinets full of findings on motivated reasoning, showing the many tricks people use to reach the conclusions they want to reach. When subjects are told, when they come in for an experiment and they're given a test, and then they're told that the test is an IQ test, then they're given the option to read more about IQ tests. They read the ones with headlines that, so suppose you're told that you scored really well on the test. Then you choose to read the headlines that say, IQ tests are really, really valid. But if you scored low, you want to read the ones whose headlines make it clear that IQ tests are a bunch of bunk. When people read a fictitious scientific study that reports a link between caffeine consumption and breast cancer, so these are undergraduate students, they're taking a psychology class, they come for an experiment, they're learning about experimental methods, read this study, are the methods good? Was the sample size big enough? What are the problems with this? If you read a story about caffeine consumption correlating with breast cancer, who is going to look for problems with the study? All coffee drinkers? Women who drink coffee find a lot of problems with that study. The difference between a mind asking, must I believe it, versus can I believe it, is so profound that it even influences visual perception. So in one study, subjects have to look at a screen as it's flashing up all kinds of symbols, and every time they correctly identify a number, they get a point, which is worth a nickel, let's say. And so if you're getting paid to recognize numbers, what's that? Oh, but what if you're getting paid to recognize letters? What's that? Okay, so people see what they want to see. As long as there's ambiguity. Now, they're not crazy. Like, nobody says if you pay people to spot an A, they're not going to say it's an A. But if there's ambiguity, and there's always ambiguity in social policy questions, if there's ambiguity, they see what they want to see. So if people can literally see what they want to see, is it any wonder that scientific studies generally fail to persuade the general public? There is no such thing as a study you must believe. It is always possible to question the methods, find an alternative interpretation of the data, or if all else fails, just question the honesty and integrity of the researchers. And now that we all have access to search engines on our cell phones, we can call up a team of supportive scientists for any conclusion we want to reach 24 hours a day. Whatever you want to believe about the causes of global warming or whether a fetus can feel pain, just Google your belief. You'll find partisan websites summarizing relevant scientific studies. Science is a smorgasbord, and Google will guide you to the study that's right for you. So that's all I'll say about that first conclusion. Intuitions come first, strategic reasoning second. And this is why we cannot persuade each other. We cannot persuade people on the other side. If you have a disagreement with people over abortion or fluoridation or anything, you cannot persuade them with reasons if their passions are engaged and if it's a team versus team situation. All right, let's move on to the next principle. There's more to morality than harm and fairness. So when I was in graduate school in the 1980s and 90s, there was a lot of research on moral psychology. It all looked at how kids develop notions of justice and fairness and also care and compassion. And that was it. But I was doing research in India. I was doing research with a wonderful anthropologist named Richard Schwader. And I learned that the moral domain is much broader and more variable outside of secular Western societies. Over time, I developed a theory with my colleagues as to what the taste buds of the moral sense are. Just as our tongues have special receptors for sweet and sour because our ancestors evolved to eat fruit. And we have receptors for glutamate and bitter and salt. We evolved to eat meat, so our tongues guide us to what's good for us. Our minds have the equivalent of taste buds that make us notice social patterns that it was adaptive to notice. So the first taste bud, if you will, is care and harm, nurturance, protection, things like that, because we're mammals. And that means that we're successful in rearing our young when we're really sensitive to issues of care, harm, vulnerability, need, things like that. So absolutely, this is innate. You could not argue otherwise. You could not argue that we learn compassion entirely from our society, that we're not born with a predisposition for it. Second foundation is issues of fairness and cheating. But here, the key to fairness is understanding it as proportionality. We're really good at keeping track of who's done what, who's cheating, who's slacking, who's taking more than their fair share. We're really sensitive. We really hate free riders and slackers. Now, what you'll see emerging is that on all of these, there's a bit of a partisan split. So on this one, everybody has this, but liberal morality, liberal politics, rests more firmly on this foundation than does conservative. On this one, everybody thinks that they value fairness, but as you'll see, there's two different kinds of fairness. Liberty and oppression, all Americans value liberty. We'll get back to that. Loyalty and betrayal. So some animals can work in groups, but they tend to be very small groups, structured by kin. Only humans can create very large groups that are not brothers, and sisters, they're not family. We are prepared for war. Our minds are prepared for war. And they're so prepared for war that we invented sports, because we can't get enough war, so we need something to occupy our war circuit, so we invented football. And then we love it so much that we invented super fandom, because we love rooting for our side in pretend war. Fifth foundation is authority and subversion. Here are displays of respect, or deference, I should say, in two very closely related species. Not that they're the same, but the ethology, the behavior is similar. And the last foundation is issues of sanctity or degradation, which you find very well developed on the religious right and in most religions. This is a medieval painting called The Allegory of Chastity. It shows the Virgin Mary in a basically a rock chastity belt with pure water flowing from a stream that comes from beneath her legs, guarded by not just lions, mind you, but lions with gold shields around their necks. So the allegorical symbolism, purity, is very, very intense. And this image of female sexuality is much, much more common on the right among social conservatives, conservatives of many religions. Here's an image more popular on the left. This is from Madonna's book, Sex, because female sexuality should be expressed, not hidden away. Here's a bumper sticker, a photo I took in Charlottesville. Your body may be a temple, but mine's an amusement park. So again, this is a big part of our culture wars, different attitudes about sexuality, purity, sanctity, all that sort of stuff. So I do research. I have a website with my colleagues at yourmorals.org. You can go there and take our surveys. You can get your moral profile. This is a graph that summarizes the results. This is 3,700 people, but we've got data from 300,000 overall. So this shows how people score on those six foundations I just showed you. People who, when you go to the site, you register. So people say they're very liberal.
give very high endorsement to the CARE Foundation. That's their top foundation. That's the one they most value. As people get more conservative, it goes down. So it's not that conservatives don't care. You know, it's not that they think it's okay to hurt animals or insult people, but their morality is just not focused primarily on care. Fairness, now this is fairness as proportionality. If you have items about equality, then it goes the opposite way. So my point is just that actually everybody cares about fairness and care, but there are different rankings. This is liberty. Now this is economic liberty. If I'd put in lifestyle liberty, which suggested gay rights, then the tilt reverses. So don't worry about the tilt there. Both value both. But the point is care is preeminent here, not here. This is really what the culture war is about, though. The culture war historically was about the fact that the left devalued those three. They just didn't think that was part of morality. Whereas on the right, all six are actually roughly equally important. So that's the social conservative morality in particular. That's the liberal morality. To illustrate this graphically, this is what the culture war used to be before the Tea Party. From the 90s through the early 2000s, this is what the culture war was about. I just Googled family, and I deliberately picked a white family with two daughters. Daughters are more vulnerable. Daughters elicit more desires to protect. And so imagine a white family in the 1990s, a white Christian family in the 1990s trying to raise its daughters. And this is a distortion of reality, but it's not a fabrication. The way the right portrayed the left, here are some of the issues. Here again, you know, sexual, this is from Madonna's book, Sex. Sex is good. Have sex in every combination you can think of. If you want to slit your tongue, that's a form of self-expression. Pierce everything on your body, that's fine. Move to Portland if your family doesn't like it. If you want to take drugs, that's your choice. If you want to burn the American flag, hey, that's great because dissent is the highest form of patriotism. If you want an abortion, that's your choice. It's not killing, it's just a choice. If you want to end your life, call Jack Kevorkian. And this is the baby Jesus butt plug. Because if you're on the cultural left, especially the far left, subversion is good. What's the highest praise for a work of art? That it's subversive. So if you can take the icon, if you can take a symbol of what those terrible, awful, nasty religious conservatives value, namely Jesus Christ, and stick it in your anus, that's an act of political defiance. All right, so these are exaggerations of what people on the left believed, but they're not made up out of nothing. So this was the argument that the right was able to make to America about the left, which was pretty compelling. And the right, the Republicans dominated from Reagan through, through sometime into the 90s, the Republicans dominated the political landscape with this kind of argument. Since the Tea Party and the recession, things have changed. The culture war issues, because the Tea Party was social conservatives plus libertarians, they had to tone down that old culture war stuff. They've now shifted more to debates over fairness and liberty. So this is a section from Obama's second inaugural address where he really pivots and really starts to articulate a liberal approach to fairness and liberty. We are true to our creed when a little girl born into the bleakest poverty knows that she has the same chance to succeed as anybody else. Let me note that Obama had one terrible line in 2008 that he was crucified for. Remember what it was? Spread the wealth. I think it's good when you spread the wealth. Now that is what the left has often believed. Obama has been very careful since that day not to say that. He never talks about equality of outcome. He talks about equality of opportunity, which is a big winner in America. So notions of fairness as equality of opportunity, and then positive liberty, the freedom that you, so the notion of positive liberty is the state has to help you get basic requirements that you can have liberty, you can have choices. So this was what Obama, since his Osawatomie speech in Kansas, he's been developing notions of positive liberty and fairness that are really the new culture war. That's what the left and right were arguing about in the last election. He talks about social entitlement programs not as a safety net to spread the wealth, but he says these things, Medicare, Social Security, they do not sap our initiative, they strengthen us. They do not make us a nation of takers, they free us to take the risks that make this country great. So he's articulating a vision. So this is a map I drew for an article I published recently, showing, I think, the new landscape, the new culture war. So both sides claim that they stand for fairness. Both sides stand for liberty. Everybody does. But they're different kinds. So positive liberty, where the government supports you so that you have liberty, that's owned by the Democrats. Whereas negative liberty, the don't tread on me, don't tell me what to do, don't regulate me, that's owned by the Republicans. On fairness, equality, especially equality of outcomes, is totally owned by the Democrats. Proportionality
is actually owned by the Republicans. Do the crime, do the time. Three strikes and you're out. Republicans much more strongly value punishment for misdeeds. Now, of course, there are exceptions. They're fine with letting Wall Street off. But the Tea Party was not actually. The Tea Party, the real social conservatives, they were really upset about the bailouts and things like that. So it's a little complicated. The point is that the old culture war over sex and patriotism is sort of moving, is quieting down, and this, I think, is the new culture war. All right. So what I'm saying is that there are real issues at stake, and those issues have changed from 10 or 20 years ago. Last point, and this one is brief, morality binds and blinds. So large-scale cooperation is very rare in nature. There are very few species that can work together in large groups. The ones that can do it are pretty much all siblings. So ants, bees, wasps, termites. This is a termite mound in Australia, 20 feet high. But they do it because they're all siblings. There's one queen who lays all the eggs. The individuals are sterile. So they're essentially a superorganism. And that's the way that nature has found to produce cooperation. There's only one exception to that rule, and that is us. Human beings have been cooperating for hundreds of thousands of years. As hunter-gatherers can work together, but still in pretty small groups. And then once we develop agriculture, bang, a couple thousand years later, we get cities. What you'll notice about the cities, though, is that whenever you get civilization and cities, you always have temples. So that's Babylon on the left, Tenochtitlan on the right. You always have temples. Religion played a crucial role in the origin of civilization. When people, in order to get together, if they make something sacred, an ancestor or a tree or a rock or a river, if they worship it, if they bow down together, if they circle it together, then they trust each other. This is part of our psychology. Morality binds us together, but then it blinds us to anything that contradicts that sacralization. We find it very natural to circle around sacred objects. These are Muslims circling around a rock in Mecca. The rock is inside that box there, but ultimately there's a boulder in there. And when we circle around, it's as though you're running a wire through a magnetic field and generates an electric current. So the metaphors of electricity and electricity polarized, electricity has two poles, positive and negative, work very well. It's a metaphor from physics, but it works very well for our political lives. I think we evolved this. We evolved this psychology of religion to bind us together around gods, but we can do it around flags. So patriotism and nationalism are based on the same underlying psychology of groupishness, of group binding. And if you treat your country as sacred, and somebody comes along and says that America committed war crimes, which John Kerry said when he came back from Vietnam, and of course he was right. Of course he was right. You always commit war crimes during a war. But if you sacralize America, you can't say that because that's treason. So morality binds and blinds, blinds you to reality. So when we do this, it pulls apart positive and negative. We are perfectly good, and the other side is perfectly evil. We have this very profound tendency towards Manichaeism. Manichaeus was a prophet in Persia or northwest Persia, the Kurdistan area, the 3rd century, I think it was, who preached that the world is a battleground between the forces of light and darkness, and each of us has to decide which side we're on. This way of thinking, of dividing the world into good and evil, is so natural to us. Whenever there's a fight, you find people demonizing the other side. They're just images from the internet. But of course, just think about the way people on the left think about Sarah Palin, or people on the right think about Pelosi or Obama. Ann Coulter on the upper right. So we have this ancient psychology of, well, what do you do with a heretic or a traitor? You don't just find them. You don't put them in jail. You have to kill them. You can sometimes banish them, but the natural thing to do, what feels right, is to burn them to death, as happened recently to Governor Christie. Can you imagine? I mean, there's a major hurricane, a storm, destroying millions of people are affected. You'd think that the leader of the state and the leader of the nation should work together, but the fact that they do is a crime to many people on the right when Christie did that. So that's the basic psychology I want to present to you. Intuitions come first. We are intuitive creatures. That's why we can't reason each other out of this. We can't reason our way across the divide. The divide is real, and it's over really substantive issues that we do need to talk about as a nation. What is fair? What is the role of government? These are important issues. It's not that one side is completely right or wrong. We disagree on that.
And that should be okay. Democracy is not about agreement. Democracy is a way of living together and doing something when you don't agree. So our democracy should be able to handle this, but it can't. Part of the reason it can't is that we are tribal creatures, and our tribalism has gotten much, much worse since the 90s, in Congress especially, but also among the people. And that's where we are. So what can you do personally? What can you specifically do tonight or tomorrow? First, I urge you all to join No Labels. Raise your hand if you're already a member. Anybody? Okay, a few of you. Good. I think it's a great organization. I don't know if anybody, I should have checked that, whether the Oregon Congress people are members of the Problem Solvers. Can anybody look that up, or does anybody know? Maybe look it up after. Well, whatever. Look it up. Well, join No Labels, give them some money, and support them. Common Cause, I think, is also a great group. Money is such a problem. Money in politics is such a problem. No Labels isn't touching that, but Common Cause is. We desperately need campaign finance reform. The third thing, and now this is where we shift to what we can do in our own lives. The basic lesson that I take away from moral psychology is moral humility. Once you realize what weird creatures we are psychologically and how biased and distorted our reasoning is, of course, we don't realize that about ourselves, but don't you think that about people on the other side? I mean, it's so obvious about that. Actually, I need to check. Raise your hand. So are you guys on the left or the right? Raise your hand if you'd say you're on the left or you're a liberal. Please raise your hand high if you're on the left or liberal. Okay, clear majority, strong majority. Raise your hand if you're on the right or conservative. Okay, actually a fair number, probably about 10% of you, 5 or 10%, which is, you know, I never find that many in an academic audience, never, ever. And it's a lot more up here than in Eugene, which was even more liberal. So it's easy to see all these things operating on the other side, but once you understand moral psychology, and if you read my book, you read the early chapters, I think you have to come to this conclusion. Why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but you do not see the log in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. This is one of the ancient truths, that we're hypocrites, and we are. We're absolutely hypocrites. We were designed that way. We've evolved that way. And it makes it difficult to have a democracy with such diversity in it. So if we're going to move forward, if we're going to succeed, we have to understand our limitations, understand that we don't see things clearly. We really don't. And that there's a lot of wisdom on the other side. I was a liberal my whole life. I set out to do this work because I wanted to help the Democrats after the 2004 debacle. And I thought the Democrats didn't know how to speak about American morality. So I set out to actually try to help the Democrats. And to do that, I immersed myself in conservative thinking. I watched Fox News. I subscribed to National Review. What I discovered is a lot of ideas that I had never encountered. I was a 40-year-old academic. I thought I knew a lot about psychology and politics. So many interesting ideas I'd never encountered. More so in National Review than on Fox News. I highly recommend National Review. You get really good writing, really smart people. But it was such an eye-opener. And what I realized, what I came to see, is that left and right are really like yin and yang. There's a great line from John Stuart Mill, a 19th century British philosopher. He says, a party of progress or reform and a party of order and stability are both necessary elements for a healthy political life. And he's absolutely right. Now, I'm not praising the Republican Party. I do think that both parties play dirty, but the Republicans have gone much more. So this is not to say everything's equal, split the difference about the parties. I think the Republican Party really needs to reform itself. I mean, I don't want to get into it. I'm not saying the parties are equal. But if you look at the long tradition of liberal thinking and conservative thinking, going back to Edmund Burke in the 18th century, Enlightenment thinkers, there's so much wisdom on both sides. And you need both to run a decent country. And so this is why, if I were to preach, my preaching would be that we all need more moral humility. And the only way to really get it is to actually meet people on the other side, have relationships. It's hard to do on the internet because there's just so much anonymous argumentation. But if you know someone on the other side, and this is a place like this is going to be especially true for the liberals. Conservatives, I'm sure you all have lots of liberal friends. You can't live in Portland without it. But liberals, raise your hand if you'd say you have a good friend who's conservative. Okay, so many of you do. Raise your hand if you don't, actually, you can't think of a good friend who's conservative. Okay, many of you don't. So I would just urge you, just talk to people. When you meet people, you sit on an airplane next to somebody, and here's the trick. To start a political conversation, start with some appreciation. Start by saying something that you think your side is wrong about, or that the other side is right about. One issue. What that does is it telegraphs that you're not in lawyer mode, you're not in attack mode, that you can actually, you're open-minded, you actually can see that they're right about something. If you do that, you'll find the conversation goes beautifully. This is just basic Dale Carnegie. If you've ever read Dale Carnegie, that's what he says. Start with appreciation. It's so simple, so obvious, but it's so powerful. So there's a lot that we can do, and if we do it, perhaps the trend in our nation will match the overall fantastic trend in the world. So thank you. Thank you so much. I'll just read you this caption. It's at the end of my book. Your mother and I are separating because I want what's best for the country and your mother doesn't. So questions, please.
Please come to the mics if you'd like to ask questions or let me know that you need the cordless, okay? Looks like we have a different...
I'm here.
So okay, please.
It's not a brilliant first question, but could you talk a little bit about the second meeting of the mines there in New Jersey? I mean, that happened, right?
Yeah. I don't know the details of it. I mean, I read about it. They had a return engagement, and Christie lost a lot of weight, right? Isn't that the other piece of it?
Yeah.
So, you know, I honestly don't know whether Christie is doing it because obviously to win New Jersey, you can't be a Tea Party. You've got to be, New Jersey's a blue state. So it's possible that this is just strategy. But Christie, I think, is the kind of pragmatist. He's not an ideal. I think he's a pragmatist. He hates the teachers' union. He's fed up with them. He's going to battle them to the death. But it's not because he's an ideologue. It's because so I like Christie a lot, and I think it was mostly sincere. But what's your question? I mean, what do you have doubts about it?
I just wonder if you think that, you know, maybe that's the beginning of something wonderful and life is going to get great.
Yeah. Well, I think right so. The more there are, especially on the Republican side, because that's where you're more likely to get... the word rhino, they're all so upset about rhinos, Republican in name only. So morality binds and blinds. The left went through its crazy PC phase in the 70s and 80s into the 90s. The left was crazy, binded and blinded, whatever. And Clinton kind of pulled them back to the center. Now it's the Republicans' turn. So the Republicans, I think, are crazy now in that sort of purification and demonization of anybody who dares to cooperate.
Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay. We'll alternate more or less. So yes.
You mentioned that the internet is the greatest ally to cognitive dissonance, and then you also mentioned
confirmation bias.
To confirmation bias, right. And then also you mentioned that anonymity spurs on a lot of vitriol. Mm-hmm. Are there any redeeming qualities of the internet that provide for decreasing polarization?
Yeah, that's a great question. Lots of people are interested in this, and I think the answer is that overall the internet makes polarization worse, but it's a mixed bag, and I think there are some... I see conflicting analyses. I mean, this is a question that sociologists and media studies people have to answer for us. We all have our guesses, and our guesses are probably mostly negative. To the degree that the internet is linking people up globally, it reduces the sense of sort of parochialism and small group that fosters a lot of the disagreement. So I think the internet has an overall good effect on humanity, but the specific effect on polarization is probably mostly negative, and it is specifically for confirmation bias. So one of the worst things about it is that it allows every crackpot theory to thrive forever and ever. Nothing can be killed. That's the worst effect of it, I think. Okay, yes.
So I do communications work with nonprofits. I spend a lot of time thinking about how to message and frame the issues that we care about. Mm-hmm. And your work is starting to make a really big splash among the people that I work with, because part of what you seem to be saying is that people on the left do a really good job of framing our issues in terms of care and fairness and equality, but that we are missing out on being able to talk to and reach a really large part of America.
That's right.
Because we're not doing a good job framing in terms of purity and loyalty and some of those other moral foundations.
Exactly.
So, you know, my question is what dialogue you've had with communications folks and what your advice is for how we can frame our work to reach those other moral foundations.
So I've had very little communication with them, in part because nobody quite knows what to make of me, because my book is actually more critical of liberals than of conservatives. So no conservatives have contacted me because they assume I'm an academic liberal. But liberal groups, so Third Way, which is a centrist group, they invited me in to speak. But very few political operatives have made any contact with me. And last year, during the election year, I the couple that inquired, I said no, because, you know, my original goal was to help the Democrats win, but now my goal is just help people understand each other, and I really want to stay nonpartisan. The best example I've seen of this intuitionist approach at work came in the gay marriage campaign of 2012, in contrast to the one of 2008. And a woman named Amy Simon, I think she's based in San Francisco, she was either a consultant or a leader, and she was involved in both campaigns. She said they used some of my ideas in the current one. If you want to see really powerful intuitionist messaging on a controversial issue, go to MainersUnited.org, like the state of Maine. So Mainers United, this was the coalition to push for gay marriage in Maine, and they won. And here's how they did it. In 2008, the campaigns were focused on rights. I should have the same rights. Why should they have this and I don't? That's not a winning argument in America. Americans are sick and tired of people whining about rights. I mean, whatever. But so that didn't work. What they did, which was so smart, is they addressed themselves to the elephant, not the rider. But the metaphor is the mind is divided like a rider on an elephant. The elephant is the intuitions. They addressed themselves primarily to the elephant, and they did it by using the very virtues that each group holds dear. So if you go to this site, it's so powerful. They have 12 videos on the site. And you have things like, rock solid Republican Maine, an older white man and his wife, and they just look Republican, and I'm a Republican, and Republicans believe in liberty, and that means liberty for everyone. And when my son told me, or when my nephew, whatever, so you get high principle, you get love. Or you get a minister, a Protestant minister and his wife. And, I'm a Christian. I believe that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. Jesus came to us, and his message was love. And that means love for everyone. It's like you get all teary. So some of them really are elevating. They're moving. And then you never see gay people. It's other people, it's conservatives, it's Republicans, it's religious people testifying for the value of liberty and love. And so that was just brilliant, and it worked.
That's funny. Amy and I are writing a book chapter about messaging around LGBT issues in schools, which is the only reason that's how I found out about you.
Oh, wonderful,
and how I
wonderful.
Got here tonight, so.
Oh, good. Oh, so tell me, so actually, yeah. So I had a conversation with Amy a couple months ago. I don't actually remember whether she had read my book or my work before the campaign. Did she, or was it just that she found that it, I mean, did she, I don't know if she got
it. I don't know if she's actually read it, but we all talk about it a lot.
Yeah. So, okay, good. Good. Okay, well, please tell her I say hello.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, yes.
You talk about personal humility. You need to have enough humility to back off and recognize that other groups have merit in their positions and so forth. That makes perfect sense until you think it's a team sport. And when I am humble, I'm deserting all my teammates, and I'm saying there's something wrong with them too, and now I'm hanging out by myself, which is not what I was built for.
Right.
What do we do about that dilemma?
Right. Well, first of all, politics has always been a team sport. There's a big difference between, let's say, intramural soccer
okay.
versus British soccer hooliganism. So in one case, it's fun to join a team. You like your teammates more. But at the end of the day, you don't hate the other guys on the other team. In fact, playing on a team doesn't, you have a rivalry, but it's a friendly rivalry. But at a certain point, in some leagues, a rivalry can be so nasty because once somebody, we think he kicked him deliberately, broke his leg, and we're so mad, it can descend into a blood, it can descend. And that's what's happened to our politics. So Recent data, how willing would you be to date somebody from the other party? That's plummeted.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's always been a team sport, but there's a difference between a team sport that demonizes
right.
and a team sport that simply disagrees. What I want is for us to get back to simple, normal disagreement. We disagree about what fairness means. We disagree about these things, but that doesn't mean you're evil, that you hate America or something like that.
No, I see that. But we're starting at the hooliganism point.
Right. We are at the hooliganism point now. Yes, that's right.
And the first guy who says, I don't want to be a hooligan like you guys are, has got problems.
Well, yes. So it's probably going to start with somebody, let's say a Republican governor in a liberal state, maybe, might be the first
That'd be
to
nice.
Do it. And then he gives cover to somebody else. And so, it takes some courage, and not everybody can do it right away. It might also be the case that the Republican Party will have to have several drubbings in the ballot box mm-hmm. before the reformers are emboldened. There are reformers out there who are saying, we need to change. And I'm so disappointed that one of the main responses the Republican Party has done is to say, our response to this is going to be to try to change the way we apportion electoral votes, to take advantage of the gerrymandering that we have succeeded in doing. I mean, that is so unconstructive.
Right.
That might help them in the next election or two, but that's going to guarantee that they're going to go 20 years as the ridiculous party.
Right. Thank you.
Yes.
If you had a thoughtful conservative and a thoughtful liberal actually communicating with each other, based on your own thinking about these moral mm-hmm. values, what might be some of the more interesting insights that each might mm-hmm. might offer the other?
Great, thank you. One thing that I like to do, I subscribe to the National Review, and also to the New Republic, which are just both great magazines, really smart people, center right and center left. And while they don't talk to each other very much personally, you read them back to back. You see they'll talk about the same news issue, and you get a lot of ideas. I think that I can tell you some of the ideas that I've gotten from both sides. Let's see. So I think one of the ideas that you get, that you see especially on the center right, is the incredible power of markets, the incredible importance of, and it doesn't mean just free market capitalism like free market like let them do anything they want. Free market means free and efficient markets. So the power of markets to solve problems is really extraordinary. And on the left, there's a real ambivalence towards capitalism. Another thing you get from the center right is the importance of family. The left has been very afraid to say that marriage matters since the 60s because that would discriminate against gay people. African Americans have low rates of marriage. So the left has been very reluctant to say that family matters. But family is incredible. Gay or straight family doesn't matter to me, but family really, really matters because when kids don't have stable adults, they have transitory adults. And we have men passing through. It's a disaster. And you need a lot more social services, more welfare. It's terrible. So I think the left can learn from the right that especially if you care about the poor, you should do everything you can to strengthen marriage and family. That's some of the okay things that the right needs to learn from the left. The way I see it, the right believes that the law of karma is operative, and they want to make sure that when people do bad things, they get punished. They want to make the law of karma work, but they're wrong in thinking that the law of karma actually does work. In other words, the law of karma says, if you're poor, it's because of something you did in a past life. And conservatives blame people too much. They don't understand, I think they don't appreciate, the role of chance. And liberals and the safety net and the whole, and especially in healthcare, I mean, my God, in healthcare, anybody can have a child with Down syndrome. Anybody can get cancer. And the fact that in this country, if you get sick, you are probably going to have to declare bankruptcy. I mean, if it's a major illness, that's insane. And so I think it's an outrage. Yeah, I think it's an outrage. And it's incredibly inefficient economically. So you want to frame your arguments? You want a healthy economy? Let people take chances. Let them know that they have security. So I think that, both... I'll stop there. But I think there's some really, both sides have a part of the puzzle. They're focused on the things they most care about, but then they go blind to the things the other side cares about. Thank you. Yes.
Hi, I'd like to see one more show of hands here. You asked the question whether you raise your left or your right arm. How many people didn't raise their arm at all? Okay.
Okay. Okay. So, now, of you guys, how many of you would say you're libertarian? Raise your hand for libertarian. Actually, anyone here, raise your hand for libertarian. What?
How about no labels?
Not a single?
I mean, is there such a thing? I guess that's what I'm...
Yeah.
Is there any trend at all? I mean, with people being so fed up with everything that's going on and these extreme labels, is there any sort of... Is there a third team any place? You talk about the two teams. Is there a third team?
I wish. So here's the way... So you're asking about centrism. So here's the way it works, as far as I know. Again, I'm not a political scientist, but my understanding is this. So it depends. If you do it by liberal conservative, what you get is about 21% of the country calls themselves liberal, about 40% calls themselves conservative. So you get about a 2-to-1 ratio, and then, of course, the remaining, you know, what is that, 60, the remaining 40% say that they're neither.
They're wishy-washy, right? No.
Well, they're in the center. And that has not changed much. So, you know, the conservative brand is down a couple points in the last year or two, but that's been pretty steady. But if you ask for party identification, I forget what the numbers are. It's now back to that more people identify as Democrat than Republican, but a lot of people say they're unaffiliated. But those people mostly, if you press them and you say, which way do you lean, they'll tell you. And then it turns out they vote just as reliably that way as the other. So a lot of people are disgusted with the parties. They don't want to say they're a Democrat or Republican, but they tend to vote one way or the other. There are certainly people who really are apolitical. Those people don't matter because they don't vote. Not everybody. I'm just saying the political, all the messaging, you know, it seems as though, well, so look, it used to be that people thought you have to win the center. And so they would aim for the center, and that was very healthy. But the reality has changed. The polarization has been such that George Bush and Karl Rove figured out in 2004 that doesn't work anymore. Now that so many more people are one side or the other, the way you win is by boosting your turnout from 60% to 64%. If you do that, you win. So, third issue here, is that centrists are not passionate. They don't mobilize. To get passionate, you need to hold something sacred. You need to be outraged. You need to be blind. Then you'll throw yourself in to the political fight.
Logic has no place. Thank you.
That's right. Unfortunately, yes. Yes. Yes.
You commented that both political parties fight dirty, and I think that's self-evident. Yeah. But it creates a bit of a quandary. Let's say that the political party that represents your agenda is caught out doing something reprehensible. So either you vote for them to further your political agenda and reinforce the behavior, or you vote for the other party and an agenda that will bring about the end of civilization, or you withdraw from the process completely, which isn't productive either. I mean, I understand joining No Labels is a step, and I'm a member, but it still comes down to casting a vote, political contributions. How do you resolve that conundrum?
Okay, so one of the big problems with our electoral system is that we've got winner-take-all voting with gerrymandered districts. Now, the gerrymandering is... So in other words, the extremists get to decide who goes to the election because we have primaries. So the real problem is the primaries. The primaries are very few people vote in them. It's only the extreme on both sides generally vote in the primaries. And if you win the primary, you're in because most districts are so lopsided. One little point. Many of you know that the Democrats got 1 million more votes for the House of Representatives than the Republicans did. And is it an outrage that the gerrymandered, you know, those Republicans, they gerrymandered, they stole the House? It's not quite true. I saw an analysis of what would have happened had there been no gerrymandering, had you just drawn compact, circular, you know, compact districts. The answer is the Republicans would have lost 6 more seats in the House. They still would control it because most of the gerrymandering is actually natural. Cities are really, really blue, and the countryside is really, really red. So the gerrymandering is actually mostly natural. But what that means is that the districts are such that the general election doesn't matter. It's all the primary. So open primaries. Open primaries where you have some sort of ranked voting system or where everybody can vote. There, you know, Iowa, I forget exactly what they do. Iowa and California have innovated on this, and that helps. If you listen to the Congress people, if you listen to the No Labels folks, the congressmen there, what they all talk about is the fear of getting primaried. If you go for the general election, if you're an incumbent, you're 90% likely to win. Their fear is getting primaried. And so we've got to change that. That will open up a space for them to not be such partisan, nasty creatures. Yes.
You said Republicans don't understand the karma of the poor, but the older American understanding of the poor is Calvinist, mm-hmm. that they're poor because God wants them to be poor and they're going to hell. How much does the legacy of Calvinism in America explain how polarized we've gotten, and can it help the sides understand each other?
That's a great question. I don't know enough of the history to know. There's a wonderful book called Culture Wars by James Hunter. He popularized the term in this 1991 book. And he traces out the biblical strand in American history, which goes back to the Puritans especially, and then the Republican strand. And he shows how the changing role of religion, and how religion didn't used to be left or right, what's happened is the religion separated so that the liberal branch, the liberal Protestants are on one side, the conservative Protestants are, the liberal Protestants are allied with the liberal Jews and liberal Catholics. So the role mm-hmm. of religion has been constantly changing. America is very different from Europe in a lot of ways, and I think you're pointing to one of them. We do tend to, when people are successful, we tend to say, God bless you, you deserve your money. Whereas in Europe, we're more likely to say, oh, you must have cheated to get that, you're a bad person. So I think that's a good part of America. But mm-hmm. it does, I think, go along with a greater tendency to blame the poor. Mm-hmm. Now, I think the left is sometimes too easy on the poor. And the left was really trying to spread welfare around in the 60s. And if you put people on welfare, you do sap their initiative, especially if it's eternal welfare. That's a terrible mm-hmm. thing to do to people. Mm-hmm. So, well, that's all I'll say on that.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. 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 We'll do. Yeah. Oh, it is. Yes. It is 8:30. So quick questions. I'll give quick answers, and then we'll break. And I think there is a books. The books are for sale in the back if you want. So yes.
It's my understanding there are two forces that are very destructive to American democracy. Big money is one.
Yes.
And the other one is sociopathy. Sociopaths in positions policy determination and so on. And I'd be interested in what your thoughts are about the Powell memo and what that has done in terms of our big money problems in mm-hmm. this country. And also the sociopathic, the sociopaths who are in positions of power.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, briefly on the sociopaths. A true sociopath or psychopath, it means the same thing, is a person with no moral emotions. They have a real deficit in social cognition and empathy. It's a heritable condition. It emerges early. There's no cure. These people tend, while they might be drawn to Wall Street and politics, you have to have such savvy political skills. Each sociopath leaves a trail of victims throughout life. They're terrible. There's no cure. Lock them up and throw away the key, I say. As soon as they commit their first crime, lock them up. I don't think many of our leaders are sociopaths. We think they are on the other side, but that's our problem. That's our demonization. Clinical sociopaths, I really don't think that's an issue in our politics. On the issue of big money, that is a huge, huge problem. Aside from the polarization, it just gives us such unbelievably bad policies. I urge you all to watch. Larry Lessig has an incredible TED Talk. It's online now. Just go to TED.com or just Google Lessig, L-E-S-S-I-G, Larry Lessig TED. He, I think, has the best explanation of what's going on. He doesn't have any solution, really, unfortunately. His book, he sort of does, but we've got to do something about it. And it's not clear that we will. So it's a huge, huge problem. I think maybe the only way that'll ever get done is if the Democrats have such a majority that they can make policy and appoint the Supreme Court justices. And so in 20 years, I think that's the only way it can get done. Because almost everything is going to help one party more than the other. And therefore, the other party is going to fight like hell against it. Yes. Yes.
One of the particular demonizations that I've noticed is the use of the word in argument of relativism. Mm-hmm. And as it's attributed to the process orientation of tolerance or compassion, openness, listening. Mm-hmm. And it's as if those people or whomever is using demonizing in terms of the label relativism or very much abiding by keeping toward precept and belief mm-hmm. and that kind of containment. Mm-hmm. Whereas in fact, it has felt to me like that polarity of compassion and liberty and process is a deeper belief trying to establish itself mm-hmm. in a much more in a very contemporary way in our culture mm-hmm. and is the very essence of what our founding fathers established mm-hmm. for this country. Okay. So the signifier relativism, of yes. relativism mm-hmm. I find is so disallowing of
so
a
let's
mutuality.
Look at, yes, that's correct. Let's put relativism and racism together. The left is always throwing the word racist at the right. The right is always throwing the word relativist at the left. They're both correct. They're both correct in this way. If you look at James Hunter, this book, Culture Wars, he makes a really astute observation, which is held up empirically, which is that the fundamental split between left and right in America is over whether or not there is an objective truth. And so if you ask people things like, I believe, you know, like the bumper sticker, God said it, I believe it, that's that. You know which way that person voted. Versus if you don't like abortion, don't have one. It's up to you. Each of us can make up our own rules, our own values. One of the things that the social conservatives hate most about the left is the relativism. And this is not a superficial charge. I go into, in my book, in much more detail, the idea of the need for it to live in a shared moral matrix. We believe there are moral truths. We act as though there are truths of physics. And the left tends to be more dubious of that. But the charge of relativism is what actually the culture is about now. So you can say it's a form of demonizing, and it is, because it's what the right most cares about and what the left is most threatening on. But before you say they shouldn't say that about the left, put yourself in their shoes and say, why are you guys always calling us racist? Just because we don't believe in welfare, or we don't, policy issues, or if you're against affirmative action, you're called a racist. There are a lot of reasons to be opposed to affirmative action. So I think both sides actually are throwing terms at the other that are about their sacred value. The left sacralizes race and gender. The mm-hmm. right sacralizes moral truth given by God. So those are real charges. Yes.
Yeah, one of the words that I've missed so far in reading your book and in your presentation, and it's a concept that I understand permeates virtually all of Western and Eastern philosophies, is the idea of moderation in all things.
Okay.
Now, you use the word, use some humility and so on, but I noticed that when you were talking about the issue of gay marriage in mm-hmm. in Maine, what I thought I saw you doing, or what I thought I saw you depicting as their successful campaign, was sort of changing the moral framework of the discussion.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder
away
if that
rights,
is not a solution also to to what the problems we're facing in the United States, to change the moral framework a little bit on this idea away from extreme polarization of issues and extreme, it's me against the country, or the country's there to protect me, and get some concept of this old ancient wisdom about moderation in all things.
Yeah, that's a great point. There are certain virtues that can work if you have a really shared culture and tradition, and there's some certain traditional virtues. A lot of people have observed, somebody observed in the last election, there is now not a white Protestant on the Supreme Court in a leadership position in Congress or in the presidency. It's the first time that's ever happened. David Brooks has written a number of times about the old WASP establishment and how well-equipped they were in many ways to lead. And one of their virtues was that sort of moderation, not showing off, being polite and civil, because they all knew each other. They had a blue book. They kept track of reputation. They had sort of the social resources to be a leadership class. Now, there's some good things about that breaking open You know, I'm Jewish, and my father's generation of Jews were born poor, and they just flourished in America. And immigrants flourished. That's great. But we've lost the sort of the single dominant culture that could support those older virtues. And America's rise of individualism, self-expression, you know, the changes in the media, the debasement of the media, it would be great if we could get that back, but I don't know if our giant, diverse, money-obsessed country can regain those virtues. There used to be a virtue called thrift. I don't know if any of you ever heard of it. It's, you know, but the credit card industry, they worked really hard to convince Americans that thrift is not a virtue. So we've lost a lot of those old virtues. Okay, last question.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about population density and how that would affect a person's political viewpoint.
Yeah. What, I mean, what's the mechanism? Why is it such a strong relationship? I don't really know, but here's my main thought on it. So a lot of my research, and what I'm, especially these more conservative foundations, loyalty, authority, sanctity, these are the ways that our species evolved to create self-governing communities before there was formal law and police departments and legislatures. So think about feudal Europe. Think about gangs in Los Angeles. Think about ways that when there's no law, how do people govern themselves? You get very kin-focused. You get authority supported by force. You get clannishness. In rural areas where there isn't as much presence of government, there's not such a police force, each man defends his home with a gun. And they can't count on the police to come help them. There's much more self-reliance and reliance on kin. And people who don't work and don't hold up their end, they deserve, it's best if they fail. And along comes the government to bail them out. Well, that destroys the basic moral fiber that lets our system work. So as you get density, you get more concentration of services offloading from the sort of the local family unit to central government. Now, the net effect of that, you know, it's a debatable question, but I think the net effect of that is generally quite positive. So the urbanizing, you know, the urbanizing trend, I think, is in part responsible for, you know, a lot of the progress that I showed in the opening slides. But I think density has various changes. Also, density tends to go with diversity. And while diversity actually can be quite divisive, diversity does actually cut trust within American communities. But it leads to a change in the nature of your politics. So I think it's the centralizing and offloading of services. It's the diversity and the mobility. It's the fact that you don't know your neighbors as much. You don't have such long relationships with them. So there's sort of more anonymity. A lot of things change when you get more of an urban lifestyle. But I don't actually know. I can't give you a definitive answer to why it has this effect so dramatically. Well, thank you all for your attention and your questions. Okay, yeah, sure. Let's do that. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, very good. All right, so yeah, so that's that. I'll just go back to the Thank you.